This is to all my friends as a holiday story for me. First, I need my holiday pipe. This story is called Rocker Santa in the Forge of Vomit. It's a rather unusual holiday tale. I hope you like it. It was 900 Kelvin on the planet with no name, the miniature daughter in a system whose sun was expanding in the throes before death. It only stood to reason that the doomed land would house the elusive figurehead in an interplanetary mythology whose derivation had long since obscured. Here, amid the melting rocks, lived the fabled Rocker Santa. Able to withstand the scathing heat of both magma and disbelief, Rocker Santa commanded his very sweaty elves to construct his abode directly under the planet's equator. 500 feet down, where the conditions were slightly less deadly, many were his enemies who traveled the stars on missions to eliminate him. One time on Alpha Ursus, a sharpshooter had ventilated his beard. Back when he was fat and lazy and much more jolly, they almost caught him. But a hard century on the run had taught Rocker Santa to improvise and adapt. Let them look. Even if they found the right planet, their primitive brains could not grasp the concept of looking for Santa at the equator. Of course, when elves are turned into sweaty little fugitives, the quality of their toycraft suffers. Hence the latest batch of rocks, with crude, almost tribal faces on them. More important to the elves was devising some form of rudimentary air conditioning for the workshop. At one point, Rocker Santa had to point out that, to the children of distant stars, it would look like they didn't give a shit about their holiday happiness. At this, the elves shrugged and fanned themselves. Lately, they had taken to referring to their new habitat as the Forge of Vomit. "Call them ancient runestones," suggested a crafty elf. "Say that they are all the rage and hint that some have unknown magical properties." Clearly, marketing had not overlooked them. "Yeah," chimed another elf. "Pretty soon you can say that they come from a planet that no longer exists." Rocker Santa frowned. "Well, I'm not going to call them anything, you little slackjaws. The shame of this workmanship is on you and whatever kind of earthen statue you dance around at night. Plus, we're all getting a little pissy today. But that's all right." And he left them to their affairs. At about 1 the following day, a scout ship from the Trachean Alliance detected faint energy readings below the surface of the nameless planet. The elves, somewhat less sweaty, were using just enough power in their newly completed air conditioning system so as to pass the mark, which Rocker Santa gave them as a limit. In his private chamber, Rocker Santa was smoking a doober and jamming out to some classic Bon Scott-era AC/DC when the lights cut out and the red glow of the backup system came on. He swore gustily and thrust down his guitar. "You little godforsaken marmots," he yelled at the elves. "Power limits are set for a reason." Yet even as he spoke, the first in a series of experimental carpet bombing commenced overhead. "The Jews have found us," whispered a red-headed elf, fearfully, as dust and bits of small debris were dislodged from the ceiling. Another nodded. "Yep, dreidel bombs." Set to land and spin wildly, dreidel bombs held a twofold destruction. First, their jagged metal sides could shred concrete as the whirlwind of their spinning carried them on random paths of destruction. And then, of course, after a time, they would explode. When two dreidel bombs hit each other, the double dreidel effect happened, producing an explosion forceful enough to set off other nearby dreidels. The elves huddled together and, seeing no reason for further covertness, cranked the air conditioning up to full blast. "We can at least die comfortable," one of them said. But Rocker Santa was in no mood for dying. He had once canoodled with the stars of stage and screen, back when people were still humble enough to put presents under trees and not vice versa. But when the super-rich started giving each other monuments and obelisks, founts which spewed cognac, and monolithic wastes of marble, it signaled the beginning of the end. No amount of frantic elf breeding could produce enough workers to craft such gigantic Christmas requests. And as a result, more and more people converted to Judaism, where at least they were allowed to grumble. Now, with the walls cracking and splintering around them, the elves took shelter in the ship which had carried them there while Rocker Santa donned his suit of black metal armor, which still retained the white faux fur trimmings. A helmet with blast shield visor replaced his classically conical cap, yet still there was a white puffball on top. His chariot had no reindeer in front, but rather highly efficient fission rockets to either side. His preferred weapon was his sack, which he could wield from its expanding, indestructible strings like a bloated, deadly morning star. When coupled with the momentum of his chariot, the concussive force of Santa's sack was equal to a megalithic battering ram. But this was not his only weapon. A single earthy button resided to the right of his dashboard. When pushed, the button triggered several supersonic speakers on the sleigh to emit the fabled and remarkably incapacitating brown note, which was a flat F in an impossibly low register, which caused sudden bowel evacuation in more than 68 known forms of humanoid life. Armed with these and a few more tricks, Rocker Santa launched his sleigh straight through the roof of the cavern, plowing through 500 feet of rocky earth with no more trouble than traversing a modest snowbank. Straight up to the stars he went, past the planet's thin atmosphere, to engage the scout ship from the Trachian Alliance. At first, their sensors seemed to think little more than ionically charged space debris was heading for them, for they were not calibrated to recognize objects of that size as spacefaring vessels. So before the bridge crew knew it, Rocker Santa came charging to the forefront of the scout ship. He swung his sack and let loose a shattering blow which struck the protective viewing glass for the bridge, which proceeded to develop several rippling fault lines. Immediately, the captain gave orders to open fire, and weapons of every size and strength available were discharged at the elusive little sleigh. Their targeting was good, but Rocker Santa would not be denied. On his second pass by the bridge, he pressed the button which released the brown note. Every crew member on the bridge, and about 60% of the rest of the ship, heard the ominous note and uncontrollably defecated. It was an utterly demoralizing experience for the crew of a military ship. They squirmed in their seats and fidgeted at their posts, their faces racked with unpleasant expressions. Shields had little effect against the properties of Rocker Santa's sleigh, and with a vehement curse he began another approach. The last vision of the helm crew was an enraged Santa, barreling toward them, unstoppable, swinging his great sack like a portent of doom. "You've been motherfucking naughty," he bellowed, and struck the weak point he had created in his viewing window. His fission rockets and attitude control stabilized his sleigh as the blast of decompression wiped out the bridge, effectively incapacitating the vessel. But Rocker Santa knew that the engineering crew likely had a secondary control and soon would steer the ship into a hasty retreat. That was not permissible. If they were allowed to report on Rocker Santa's position and offensive capabilities, he and the elves would be that less safe at their next temporary home. From the floorboards of his sleigh he drew up a great harpoon. The shaft was an indestructible metal which he and the elves had discovered on a three-moon planet in the Ryobi system. Propelled to frantic speed by a controlled atomic burst within a firing chamber which encased it, the harpoon tore through each and every deck of the Trachian ship from stem to stern. It cut through engineering and deactivated their warp core. Rocker Santa reloaded. In a short time, he sent enough rounds through the vessel so that it resembled a misshapen metal pincushion, venting atmosphere and without propulsion. Then it was an easy matter for Rocker Santa to make a few passes with his sack a-swingin', to destroy their antennae, dishes, and other communications equipment. He realized it only bought himself and the elves time to run and establish themselves elsewhere. He knew he could never beat the Jews or their various allies. The more militant he became, the harder it was for people to keep him as the figurehead for holiday celebrations of peace. But this year, he had rocks to deliver, rocks with some crude faces carved in, giving away pieces of more ground he had lost. I hope you like that, guys. Happy holidays, everyone.